I apologize. We now resume our meeting. At the last meeting on December 2nd, we have a paper of a list of follow-up actions, and the administration has given us a response, which is paper CB2477/1920/02. May I now invite the Deputy Secretary for Food and Health, Ms. Amy Yun, to brief us on the written response by the administration, and then we open the floor for questions. Thank you, Chairman. Mr. SHIU Ka-fai gave us some proposal for amendments, and we also received a request for written response. So I would like to give a combined response, if that is all right. Yes. On December 2nd of 2019, at the Bills Committee, there were some lists of follow-up actions arising from the discussion, and together with the draft amendments proposed by Mr. SHIU Ka-fai, we gave written responses, and now I'd like to share with you the highlights on these two responses. In the written response, we've already supplemented information in prevalence of smoking among junior high school students in Japan in 2014 and 2017. I have to point out that the prevalence of smoking has been going down worldwide, and actually there's no evidence that the use of heat-not-burn products has contributed to decreasing smoking prevalence. In the last meeting, we used the figures of high school students in Japan, and on the increasing rate of HNB use among Japanese adolescents aged 15 to 19, and that actually prohibition of sale will not be effective in preventing youth from getting hold of these tobacco products. And in a Korean study, we show that 2.8% of Korean adolescents aged 12 to 18 had used heat-not-burn products. Amongst those, 75.5% and 90.7% were current and ever cigarette smokers, respectively. So this shows that the greater majority of HNB users are also using cigarettes. And it shows that a significant portion of HNB product users actually also use conventional cigarettes as well. And in our written response, we also gave the figures on the smoking trend in Korea in the past 5 years. It should be noted that since 2007, since HNB products were introduced to Korea, there have been a prevalent of increased usage of HNB products. 96% of smokers actually use both traditional cigarettes and HNB products. Actually, this is not beneficial to us at all. We'll only increase the number of smokers. Therefore, we believe that a total ban on HNB products will be effective in decreasing the number of smokers in Hong Kong. At the last meeting, we also quoted from Hong Kong Council on Smoking and Health, which is the signatory campaign to gather public support for a total ban of these smoking products. We gathered 75,000 signatures from citizens. COSH submitted a paper in April last year, and the signatory campaign website shows around 53,000 online signatures have been received. And these actually do not include the submissions collected through various activities held by COSH and supporting medical associations, as well as through education campaigns in primary and secondary schools. Mr. SHIU Ka-fai suggested excluding heat-not-burn products from the definition of alternative smoking products in draft Schedule 7 to the bill. We have to reiterate that for the protection of public health, we still believe that a full ban covering HNB products is the most effective measure. We do not agree to the creation of a new category of novel tobacco products to formally regularize HNB products in exchange for a ban on electronic cigarettes. All tobacco products are definitely harmful to health and highly addictive. HNB products are designed to appeal to the younger generation. A rapid uptake of these products amongst youth has been observed in Japan and Korea upon their introduction in the market. There are also population data indicating that a great majority of HNB product users are dual users of conventional cigarettes. We are very concerned with public health. If we include HNB products, then it will seriously undermine public health and our ongoing efforts on tobacco control. Our proposed ban is well justified by scientific evidence and is best for the protection of public health in Hong Kong. KOSH, academics, and parent-teacher groups have shown strong support to banning both e-cigarettes and HNB products from medical and healthcare professionals, parents, teachers, youth, and the general public. Therefore, we have great difficulty in agreeing to the proposal to exclude HNB products from the ban under the amendment bill. We understand that some members oppose to HNB products inclusion. However, we have to insist on a precautionary approach to impose a full ban in order to prevent the introduction of a new class of addictive and harmful tobacco products for safeguarding public health. We hope members will agree with us that we need to work in the interest of public health. Thank you. Thank you, Deputy Secretary. Secretary has reminded me that I have to give Hsu Ka-fai an opportunity to introduce his proposal of draft amendment. Mr. Hsu, do you need to speak on that? Chairman, I submitted my CSA. Yes, we have already seen it. I think members have already seen the paper. I really can't go through all the details, otherwise it would take a very long time. Some people think that e-cigarettes, especially in the US and Canada, that they are detrimental to the health of young people. E-cigarettes can actually have poison or liquid poison ingested. I want to separate e-cigarettes and HNB products because there are many such examples in Canada and in the US. In Hong Kong, in the past 1 year or so, there have been figures introduced to mislead the public. Young people around the age of 12 are using HNB products. I agree with you, it should be banned. Therefore, I introduce my proposal to exclude heat-not-burn products. Instead, you include e-cigarettes. Well, you're saying that I do not work in the interest of public health. Are you hinting that I don't mind people dying from inhaling smoke from tobacco? Well, Mr. Hsu, you're actually briefing us on your draft amendment. Well, I have heard what the DSA, your You're implicating that I'm actually not safeguarding public health. You use Japan as an example by giving us data on smokers. I asked you about the use of tobacco of Japanese adolescents aged 15 to 19. You cannot give me the figures. You only tell us that there is a decreasing number. So it has nothing to do with HMB products. So does that mean that you don't need to do anything? Well, since the worldwide trend is decreasing, you don't need to do anything. There's nothing for you to do. Of course, there must be some reasons, because there is tobacco control all around the world, which is why there have been a reducing number of smokers. How can you prove to me that HNB products have nothing to do with that? What is your reason behind it? How can you prove that it has nothing to do with HNB products? Chairman, there are many manufacturers worldwide that produce e-cigarettes. There have been many examples of adolescents in past years. Yet, the Food and Health Bureau has never done anything to ban e-cigarettes. It's inexpensive, and you see all these adolescents using it. Therefore, this is the reason why I am raising my CSA. Many countries now understand more about HNB products. Originally, they banned it, but now they are relaxing the restrictions. New Zealand has actually relaxed its ban from full ban to a relaxation of the ban of HNB products. Since the last meeting, four more countries have. Mr. Xu, please be brief. I'm just asking you to move your motion. Other members are waiting to speak as well. Well, I can summarize that you want to separate e-cigarettes and heat-not-burn products because everyone agrees that e-cigarettes are hazardous to health, yet you have another opinion on heat-not-burn products. Am I right? Well, yes, you're very concise. But I still want to speak on it. Do you have a time limit? Well, how much time do I have? Well, I'll give you 3 more minutes. That's all right. 3 minutes is all right. Well, because after you speak, I'll open up the floor to other members. Mr. Tommy Chung. You are actually connecting the administration's response to the CSA, but can we actually separate the two? Because I may have other CSAs as well. Perhaps we should just focus on the administration's response right now before we move on to the CSAs. I think it's better to just focus on the response first. Otherwise, we're just going to combine everything together and it's confusing. Well, thank you, Mr. Chung, for your views. When Mr. Xu moved to CSA last time, we agreed to let him speak first because he thought that we might all change our views after hearing his CSA. Right now, we do not yet have any other CSAs. There is a reason why I let him speak first. 3 more minutes for Mr. Xu, please. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Peter Xu. Well, Mr. Tommy Chang just reminded us, are we discussing the CSAs now? No, I'll have your personal take first. So there'll be a chance for me to go back to other outstanding issues, right? Before we move on to the clause-by-clause scrutiny. Yes, you're correct. Like I said HNB products should be separated from e-cigarettes. This is not just coming from me. There are many countries, many states telling you the same. They believe they should be regulated. This is not coming from an enterprise, not an individual. This is coming from countries. Since last time we discussed the matter, four more countries have agreed with this principle. This is the global trend because we do not have a lot of HMB products. We don't have a lot of manufacturers. These are major market players. They have done a lot of research. I've never ever said that HNB products are good for your health. I'm just saying that it's less harmful, it contains less contaminants, it has a lighter taste, and perhaps less harmful to our health. So why shouldn't we be given this choice? The administration has said no to my suggestion. So the administration will continue to have its supporters, it's all right. We can all have our own positions. But Ms. Yun just now said that I'm not putting public health first. And I do have a strong objection to this statement. I'll give the floor to her now. Please explain. Anything you'd like to add, Ms. Yun? Deputy Secretary? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Shu, for his comments. Well, if we talk about putting what first, I think there are a number of things we need to consider. I think we raised different viewpoints after in our discussion. Or should we just suspend the meeting and then listen to the playback? Are you really picking on me? No, we're just discussing the bill. Anything to add? If not, well, members, I think we may have different views on what should go first. Now, my suggestion is this. Mr. Peter Shill proposed CSAs, which in his view could be a turning point in our scrutiny work. We agreed before we move on to clause-by-clause scrutiny, I would give him the chance to walk us through his amendments first. It doesn't mean we need to vote on them. The administration should also get an understanding of Mr. Shill's amendments. So I'm going to allow members to discuss and express your views on the CSAs proposed by Mr. Shill. So perhaps after listening to our views, the administration would go back and collate them, and then I will open the floor again for members to put questions relating to the general policy. Mr. Tommy Cheung, I don't have any strong views. Well, just now, she went on for about 10 minutes. I read her letter, and I do have views on her letter as well. Say, like this one, CB2477/1920/02. Frankly, Chairman, I hope I'll be allowed to ask questions relating to this as well. So there should not be a time limit. Is that your suggestion? Because, my memory slips, I'm aging, and I'd like to put questions while I still remember them. So if you have views on the on any matter, CSA, the administration's response, etc., you may raise your hand. Thank you, Mr. Tommy Zhao. First round, we have Dr. K.K. Kwok, Dr. Pierre Chen, Mr. Tommy Cheung, and Mr. Peter Shill, and also Mr. Wong Teng Kwong. Shall I give 5 minutes to each member? Questions and answers included. Dr. K.K. Kwok. First of all, I support the administration to regulate e-cigarettes and heat-not-burn products as soon as possible. And I find it unacceptable for Mr. Peter Shill to suggest excluding HNB products from e-cigarettes. As we know, since the beginning of the tobacco industry, especially in recent years. Heat not burn products have become the major highlight of the tobacco company's marketing campaign. More than one multinational tobacco corporations have expressed that HNB products will constitute 40% or more of their total profit. And like Deputy Secretary just said, in other countries such as Japan, many young people smoke conventional cigarettes as well as e-cigarettes at the same time. And this is really not something new. Say, we have young people smoking HNB cigarettes in places where smoking is not permitted, so as to address their addiction. We have a smoking prevalence of 10%, and it's all because of our hard work. And we face a very strong opponent. We have the multinational tobacco manufacturer with powerful lobbyists and hefty donations to make sure that heat-not-burn products can be introduced in the market. In 2018, B&J, the British Medical Journal, conducted a research on cytotoxicity brought about by tobacco products. That is in terms of whether there will be a mutation of cells leading to carcinoma. HNB products seems more harmful than e-cigarettes. There may be different markets for these two products. E-cigarettes may not be the cup of tea for conventional tobacco companies. For conventional companies, they have their own HNB products. They have the different Marlboro HNB products nowadays, whereas for e-cigarettes, it's not the same. And definitely, HNB products are not something for easing addiction or quitting smoking. If you want smoking cessation, you need to adopt a medical method such as counseling. And you cannot really quit smoking by adopting a novel cigarette product such as e-cigarette or HNB product. This is impossible. I hope all members would understand our plight. We have a multinational corporation that is really huge with a lot of lobbyists. We're facing a strong challenge. These manufacturers are really wealthy with a vast, powerful network. And frankly, HNB products, it's a really profitable business. So some members are suggesting that we should let HNB go and just regulate e-cigarettes. But that's where the money is. E-cigarettes cannot really help sell tobacco for Marlboro. But HNB products, for example, in Japan, is now become a very useful tool. It's really marketable. So, DS, my question is this. In the face of this huge predicament with different political parties advocating the ban on e-cigarettes, what is your approach? And have you noticed this trend of tobacco companies marketing e-cigarettes and HNB cigarettes? And if that is the case, how will you cope with the challenge? DS? Be it e-cigarettes or HNB products, we try our best to provide the information we have relating to other countries. HNB product is relatively new, so we tend to have more information about e-cigarettes. But the situation gets worse after years of development, and that's the case for e-cigarettes. We reckon that the same could happen to HNB products, because like Dr. KK Kwok said, major tobacco companies would spare no effort in marketing their products. So as far as our lobbying work is concerned, apart from our work in this council, the Department of Health as well as COSH have been explaining the situation to the public. And that applies not only to e-cigarettes, but also HNB products. So far, we have not seen any active campaigning by tobacco companies. And perhaps the Department of Health can elaborate on this, Dr. Pierre Chan. Thank you, Chairman. I have two questions. First, the meeting was rescheduled a number of times. Last time, on the 2nd of December 2019, I wrote a letter for the Bills Committee to be forwarded to the administration via the Secretariat. The letter reference is 2299/1920-01. First of all, I'm not sure if I received a reply. I'm not sure if this is uploaded to our website, because indeed the administration responded, but I can't see that being uploaded. I'll see if the administration will give me an oral response now. Second, during the epidemic, when this meeting was postponed a few times, I also wrote to the Bills Committee. I don't know whether the letter had been received from my office. It seems that the letter had been received. And I'd like to confirm that. And I am concerned about the timetable for this bill. In fact, I mentioned it at the first meeting. My own assessment is that we may not be able to complete the scrutiny within our term. So my question is for the administration to give us their assessment on the timetable. Next, I must say I don't agree with the CSAs. I hope the administration would take a serious view on the BC's work and introduce a complete ban on all novel tobacco products. Before the administration takes the floor, let me say that about the letter dated the 2nd of December, according to the Secretariat, your letter was received, but not the one after December 2nd. And then there is a letter dated the end of April suggesting the discussion of a few matters. We originally scheduled a meeting in April, but because of extension of the group gathering ban, we now have the meeting. Well, but can we include these letters on the website of the Bills Committee? Not the one from December to April, right? Next. Thank you, Chairman. Dr. Pierre Chan referred to a letter dated the 28th of November. We gave a reply on the 4th of December. If my memory serves me right, the letter has been included in last meeting's agenda. What about the timetable? Right, I just want it to be uploaded to our website. What about your estimation of a timetable? I think we are clear that if the bill is not passed before the council is paroled this July, we may need to start afresh. So we are in early May. Our position is very clear. And we'll do our best to work with members and answer members' questions and facilitate your discussion so that the Bills Committee can complete this work as soon as possible.
I'd like to follow up on the timetable. We all understand that the session will come to an end. So please share with us the timetable. So going back to CB 2247/1920/01, My previous question is to ask for overseas experience. To share with us, I quite like this model. So when you are sharing with us a view, then you can give us some proof or evidence. I do not believe everything you say. I will go and fact check to ensure that this is accurate. I hope that you have done the same for the questions that I asked you before. Well, some people think that H&B products are not hazardous, and you share with us information or facts that you know. I really applaud you for doing that. Mr. Tommy Chang, 5 minutes, please. Chairman, I want to follow up on Pierre Chan's question. We discussed the Medical Council last year, and I remember we put this up in May. And we do have members claiming a division every day, and we're not able to discuss it in a speedy manner. Well, today for this bill, we still haven't started the clause by clause scrutiny, and we're still trying to resolve issues members are not clear about. I don't see how we can submit this to the council before the end of session. I understand that some members only know to claim a division. They didn't move any CSAs. They only wanted the meeting suspended. Now, I am not asking for attendance. I just want to say that I haven't moved my CSAs. The housing panel is holding its meeting next door. I don't know when a division will be claimed there, and we need to go over to the next room. Well, I don't really mind. I have all the time in the world. If you don't choose the day on which EXCO has its meeting, then I don't mind being here every day. I'm just worried that we are wasting our time here. I'm concerned for you, Chairman. You are still young. We are old already. We don't mind. But you wouldn't want to waste your time. Perhaps you could give us a more firm timetable. Administration? To us, we hope to go into clause by clause scrutiny as soon as possible and to submit it to council as soon as possible. We, of course, want to complete this work in an expeditious manner. Well, don't just keep on criticizing us. This is not going to speed things up. You haven't seen my CSAs yet. You haven't even seen my questions. My questions are not many. I'm talking about 8 or 10. Don't try to beat around the bush. Let me first ask one of my questions. DS, you gave us examples on Japan and Korea right now. Japan seems to deal with e-cigarettes and H&B products separately. Do you know that? Well, yes, we know that sales of H&B products are allowed. Well, they deal with these two products differently. So e-cigarettes are under pharmaceutical products, and HNB products are under tobacco. Am I accurate? Yes. Shiu Ka-fai likes to always quote Japan as an example. Maybe you're one of the few million who loves going to Japan. You're asking for a ban of e-cigarettes, yet not HNB products. Well, you said that it's hazardous to health. Frankly speaking, sodium and sugar are not beneficial to someone like me. Well, I have to sit here attending a meeting instead of taking an afternoon nap. And this is not good for my health either. I have never tried e-cigarettes nor HNB products. 50 years ago, I took a cigarette. Why do you still only focus on certain issues and not others? Do you have any response? We mentioned figures in Japan because HNB products are sold in the market and we can find such market data. We are worried that adolescents will use HNB products, and that is the reason why we quoted numbers from Japan. In Japan, adolescents aged 15 to 19 should not be able to buy HNB products. Only adults can purchase HNB products. Yet, we still see an increasing number of HNB product users. Subsequently, if we only regulate HNB products and not impose a full ban, we might also see the same happening here in Hong Kong. I would like to ask a second round. Yes, Mr. Shiu Ka-fai. Thank you, Chairman. The DS believes that HNB products are hazardous to health and therefore will not accept my CSA. I want to ask her, as I mentioned last time, the US FDA believes that HNB products are also a principle that it can safeguard health. Then how can you explain that even by excluding HNB products, it will still be hazardous to health? Yes, thank you. If do not impose a full ban of HNB products, we are concerned with the consequences. We hear many people not banning HNB products because people believe that it is not as dangerous as traditional cigarettes. The emission might be less, but it doesn't mean that it will be less hazardous to people's health. Therefore, we believe that this new product may pose an appeal to people. People who do not smoke might want to try this novel experience, and therefore we believe it not to be in public interest to permit the use of HNB products. The FDA allows the sales of H&B products, yet it doesn't admit that it is not detrimental to health. They are looking for products that can reduce hazards. But the FDA does not admit it. The FDA has different regulations than us. But actually, we did not say, or the FDA does not say that it's actually less harmful tobacco. Did I say that H&B products are less harmful products? I'm saying that the FDA did not admit it. Why are you saying that it's less harmful? Well, I'm not a manufacturer. I don't know how they submitted it. The FDA will just approve it if they think it is valid. You're saying that it is for protection of public health. I don't understand why you are saying all that or putting words in my mouth. Well, you say that those who use H&B products also smoke traditional cigarettes. Well, actually, if they already smoke traditional cigarettes, then they wouldn't use H&B products. It's much like saying that those who drink coffee will also drink water or drink tea. If you only drink water, then you will not be taking in any caffeine. I don't know. I don't drink coffee. But if there is no water available and you have to drink coffee, would you die immediately? Well, Hong Kong is not unique. Many places in the world also use H&B products. It's just that some countries allow the use of H&B products legally. Do you know how many people actually use H&B products in Hong Kong? Do you know about the black market? Can you give me a number of how many people actually use H&B products in Hong Kong? Well, you can still be imported as long as you pay taxes. Do you know how much taxes you can take in each year by H&B products? Well, I think it's time for the next speaker. Well, can you actually give me more time? There are not too many people waiting. Well, I'm sure that you would ask for another round. Mr. Wong Ting Kong. Thank you, Chairman. According to the response by the administration, which is CB/2477/1920/02, it said that in Korea, those who use H&B products and also traditional cigarettes have a very high percentage. I don't know which number is accurate. One is in paragraph 4, 75.5% and 90.7%. And also in paragraph 8, another number which is 96%. How do you understand these three numbers? I still don't quite know how you understand it. In other words, they're users who are dual users, but now you are banning H&B products yet not banning cigarettes. So that means you're forcing smokers to go back to traditional cigarettes. The DS mentioned one point just now, that H&B products, since you do not need to burn it, there's not as much of an impact on the environment. Well, we have a Chinese saying that you choose the lesser evil. But then if you do that, or you adopt what you're trying to do, you're not choosing the lesser evil, you're choosing the greater evil. So I want you to consider this, to try to reduce the number of users of traditional cigarettes and try to not force HNB product users to go back to traditional cigarettes.
Second, if you ban e-cigarettes, does it mean that you can eradicate smoking of conventional tobacco products among adolescents? Do you have any specific measures or policy that are quantifiable in order to convince us that after you ban HNB products, you can eliminate adolescents smoking, which means that they don't smoke HNB or conventional cigarettes? Point number three, in relation to all the papers from the administration and campaigners, these words always crops up, and that is public health. It seems that you're on such moral high grounds. If conventional tobacco products are even more harmful than HNB cigarettes, then why aren't you impose a blanket ban? Standing on such moral high grounds, why doesn't the government do it? My fourth question is this. Smuggling conventional cigarettes is a really profitable business for syndicates. Now, if you ban HNB products, such that its import, marketing, manufacturing, sale are all prohibited, and yet if you don't impose a ban on smoking HNB products, you will be creating a big loophole on smuggling HNB. And how are you going to deal with that? These are the four questions I put to the administration. Oh, the doctor is not here, but I do have a question for him. He said recently tobacco companies have been very active in promoting HNB cigarettes. I can't help but wonder the justification of this statement. I don't see any street campaign, publicity campaign, advertisements in TV stations, radio stations, nothing at all. What kind of publicity was he referring to? What kind of promotion? You need to give me examples. You can't just make an arbitrary statement like that. Now, the doctor also mentioned that he would like to see early passage of the bill. My feeling is that we have an impasse at the House Committee. So, despite our hard effort, despite our hard work to complete scrutiny of the bill here, what will happen then? This afternoon, we just received some papers from the President of the Council referring to the legal advice sought, so on and so forth. So, does it mean that Dr. Kwok supports the idea that we can have a meeting for the election of chair, whereas the former chair of the House Committee could continue with other businesses such as this bill? Otherwise, the HC is now paralyzed. Without a chairman, how are we going to complete our work? Next, Mr. Ray Chen. Chairman, first of all, I'd like to comment on the progress of our scrutiny of this bill here. It has nothing to do with the progress of the House Committee because we're not even reaching the clause-by-clause scrutiny stage yet. There is a big question mark when we're going to complete our work here at the Bills Committee. Sorry, please stop the timer. Let me appeal to members who are in the complex now. Members who are who are members of the Bills Committee, please come back to this room. We should have 34 members. After Mr. Ray Chen and myself have spoken, I will explain our timetable to members. So if you're concerned about this bill, please come back to the room now. Back to you, Mr. Ray Chen. In fact, you just answered my question. You're going to deal with the schedule in a moment. I mean, the timetable. I think Dr. Pierre Chen's question or letter to the administration is really pointless. The administration should not interfere with the council's business or when second reading of the bill should be resumed. Yet we do need to ponder this question. In other words, whether members should put their heads together and decide our way forward. Say if the scrutiny is not completed by July, we'll need to start from scratch, and that is a reality we have. However, it's another question we should, as a result, expedite our work here. Because, say, if the administration wishes to have a bill passed, say for the co-location arrangement, as long as there are enough votes, it will make it happen. Say, Chairman, you haven't said that the next time we must start scrutiny of the bill. I think Mr. Peter Shiu is trying to help our committee by floating CSAs at this early stage. We're not supposed to discuss CSAs yet. And Chairman, you have been so understanding as to try to resolve conflicts. Now coming back to the issue, if the majority of members believe that we cannot have monthly meetings or bi-weekly meetings until the end of the term in order to complete the Bills Committee's work, we should then make a decision. We should not just sit and pretend that we are making progress. If the reality is that we won't be able to reach clause-by-clause scrutiny before July. Anyway, on Mr. Peter Shiu's amendments, I think these are heavy worded. In the third paragraph, all tobacco products are harmful to health. If not for historical entrenchment, etc. These are really strong words. It seems that all products should be banned after all. And then according to the administration, if Mr. Shiu's CSAs are passed, it will be harmful to public health. But the question, like the other member mentioned, is that why should it seriously undermine public health? Because tobacco users would just switch to conventional cigarettes if other products are banned. So what do you call it? Is it a threshold effect? How is it justified? Anyway, this is a question for the administration. Coming back to this point, most HNB product users are dual users of conventional cigarettes rather than switching from or quitting conventional cigarettes. And then in view of potential population and health impacts, so on and so forth, we're talking about things a year or two ago. Well, we're now in the middle of 2020. It's been more than a year since the bill was introduced. I think the administration should collect more up-to-date data, say, for support this argument at least, if not data supporting both sides. And then the other paragraph, youth and the general public all show strong support to banning both e-cigarettes and HNB products. Well, I do have a big question mark on this. What is the sample size of the survey conducted by COSH, the Hong Kong Council on Smoking and Health? It's been more than a year since we started our work. Do you have any up-to-date local survey? Are you going to conduct other research or not? Well, we have the Customs and Excise Department representatives here, and I have a question. Under the current legislation, I'd like to know the enforcement situation regarding e-cigarettes and HNB products. I heard that you will conduct raids at shopping malls. But in theory, it is not against the law to buy the heater. But if you buy the HNB tobacco product itself, then you will take the conventional approach in your rates. In other words, there is no legitimate way for them to pay duty and have HNB products sold in markets in a legitimate manner. And I want to know whether you have recent prosecution figures in your recent operations. I'd like to have the updated information about enforcement against tobacco products, e-cigarettes and HNB products. DS, any response? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chen, for his comments. Well, we need to respond to your point about conventional cigarettes. There is a suggestion in our discussion why we're only banning e-cigarettes and not conventional cigarettes. Now, borrowing the member's statement just now, conventional cigarettes are not banned due to historical entrenchment. Now that HNB or e-cigarettes are new, we don't want history to repeat itself. And regrettably, we cannot ban conventional cigarettes now, but we do have a target. We'd like to lower the smoking prevalence and to give advice. HNB products are new. They have not been formally introduced into our local market. We have limited data as a result. Whereas in Japan and Korea, these are the countries we picked in our research exactly because they have these products available in the market. And the trend is worrying. There is therefore justification for us to believe that if we introduce a new product into the market, it will undermine our efforts on tobacco control. Well, seriously undermining your tobacco control, so on and so forth, but there is no need to say it will seriously undermine public health. On enforcement figures, I think the Department of Health can elaborate on this point. E-cigarettes. By e-cigarettes, we refer to those products containing tobacco. As for HNB, I'll defer to the Department of Health. Say for e-cigarettes, our enforcement approach is that the current legislation provides that it must not contain nicotine. So for e-cigarette shops, we take samples and we also mount operations on receipt of intelligence. And we also act on complaint. We mount joint operation with C&E department to see whether these shops are selling products that contain nicotine. As for enforcement action against HNB product, HNB contains tobacco, so it is subject to the Dutiable Commodities Ordinance. So if no declaration is made at the time of import, it will be treated as duty not paid cigarettes. In 2019, we neutralized 639 cases involving 5.9 million cigarettes, accounting for about 4% of total illicit cigarettes seized. Well, can one pay duty for legitimately bringing in HNB products? There is no official importer exporter for introducing HMB products. For individual passengers, if they make declarations at the time of entry, this is possible. Say if a declaration is made with us, then for mailing such a small parcel, we can ask for duty to be paid.
Thank you. Now it's my turn to speak. In 2014, I requested the government to ban e-cigarettes. Unfortunately, that the government was busy at that time and was unavailable to work on that, and it was delayed till 2017. And then we argued about it, and in the beginning, we only talked about regulation. Now we're talking about total ban, and now not only do we include cigarettes, we also include e-cigarettes. Well, if it had been done early on in 2014, then it would not be such a controversy right now. At that time, Wong Ting Kong also looked at it as a lesser evil. I, however, considered it from trying to get the best of both worlds. When we started discussing it in March of last year, well, actually, it's the eighth meeting today. We've held only eight meetings in the last 13 months. The first meeting was spent on discussing introduction. We held three public consultations in between then and now. We held meetings in May, June, and then also in December, and we spent three meetings to discuss the pros and cons and also the principles of the bill. Theoretically, there should have been enough time for discussion. Shall we now move on to clause by clause scrutiny? However, I have to go back to why I say that we want to get the best of both worlds. After all the hearings with the public, we hear views from smokers that HNB products are not as stinky as traditional cigarettes. Smokers and their families all agree that HNB products do not emit as much smoke as traditional cigarettes. I see there has been a reduction in traditional smokers due to many reasons. Their family members might have objected, and they might be deterred by the signs on the packages. And now with HNB products, there is less stigma because of less odor. There's a reduction in number of traditional smokers because of the stigma. Well, now, taking aside the stigma, there might be more appeal for the public, especially young people, to take up smoking with HNB products. So now they're still discussing whether we should stick with what's happening now or try to focus on the longer run. The administration chose a total ban, yet members hope to relax HNB product restrictions. We still need to come to a decision. Any further delay would mean an empty window period for both traditional cigarettes and HNB products, which will be even worse. Now, this is my understanding from our discussions in the past year. Many members have made proposals and CSAs and also about the suspension we have because of HC. Let's go back to a more realistic question then. We held meetings in January, February, and March, and we did not have a quorum to hold the meeting in January. In February and March, we had to suspend the meeting because of the virus. If we want to this to make it to council in July, then we would need this to be in HC by June. Of course, it's also up to whether we could elect a chairman for HC. Can members work with me and try to support me in submitting this to HC in June? This is actually quite a long bill. It might take 2 to 3 meetings to go through all the clauses, and with CSAs, it might take 5 to 6 meetings. That means we'll need to hold 5 to 6 meetings in a month. Could you all work with me on this? If yes, then I would try to arrange it to the best I could. But if you are moving your CSAs just because you want to delay this further, then that is a different matter. So this is the reality we're facing right now. Do you have any views on the timetable I propose? 2 minutes each, Mr. Tommy Chang. It's going to be very difficult for me to attend 5 meetings within a month. I don't know why electrical meetings are always held at times when I'm unavailable. You haven't seen my CSAs, Chairman. There are a few questions that have not yet been resolved. I'm not trying to be condescending here. Because we see many experienced officials here, yet they are trying to beat around the bush. They should not be at this bureau. They should actually work in the Home Affairs Bureau instead. And they're not answering any of my questions and just trying to pick arguments with us. How can we continue even if we're able to arrange for 5 meetings within a month? I apologize. I do not agree. Even if you hold 10 meetings within the next month, you will not be able to resume a second reading in council because you haven't seen my CSAs yet. Thank you. Mr. A. Chen, thank you. Any controversial bill which also affect human rights? Well, although we have 30 or 40 people in our committee, only 10 of us are more outspoken. The others are just waiting to vote. I don't think there will be enough votes if you just continue with this bill. You might need more time to persuade the members. If you want to rush through this bill and just try to put it up to HC so that there will be one more item waiting in line, it's not beneficial to anyone. It will just give people the impression that we just want to match the speed of the administration. You're now refusing to make any concessions. You're just closing the doors on yourselves. You want to scrutinize the bill as soon as possible, but I'm sure you know yourself that there are many obstacles ahead. I don't think the committee should just try to rush this through, because I don't think there will be enough votes. We have given our views today. You have to consider how you can handle this matter. Mr. Pierre Chen, I just want to know about the timetable. I'm trying to be reasonable here. I just don't think that there is enough time to debate or discuss about the bill. I've said so in the beginning. Well, when we were discussing about co-location, we held a meeting every other day. If we want to do so, of course, we can try to arrange more meetings. However, I don't think that we have enough time to discuss this and submit it to the council before the end of session. Well, if you're so capable of completing it and submitting it to the HC, I still don't think there's enough time. This is just my observation. I'm not sure if I'm correct. And I think it's quite all right for members to ask questions. It's all right if there's not enough time for discussion. That's all right. Even for the bill on medical council, even though we didn't have enough time last time, we were able to do it this year or this session. Since this is a controversial bill, it's all right if it doesn't get passed. This is just our normal procedures in Legislative Council. If you try to pick the lesser evil H&B products, that, well, you'll have to ban traditional smoking or try to ban traditional cigarettes and only choose H&B products. That's the meaning from the Chinese saying, by trying to pick the lesser evil. I just hope that you understand. Mr. SHIU Ka-fai, 2 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Well, we are the active ones in this bill's committee, and you have heard all their views. We have met with you privately many times. The whole world knows the hazards of e-cigarettes, especially e-cigarettes that do not come, that are not manufactured in legal manufacturers. Many young people hold e-cigarettes in their hands. No one is objecting to the ban of e-cigarettes. I already told you last time that I'm moving a CSA to work together to safeguard the health of young people. If you accept it, then I'll try to persuade others. No one is objecting to my CSA. We want to try to uphold our principles. All over the world, we see the use of H&B products. We cannot just include this together with e-cigarettes and mislead the people of Hong Kong. If you agree to take out HNB products from e-cigarettes, then you would be actually helping the young people.
So about the timetable for future meetings, any other members would like to speak? Well, I said at the outset that we have 34 members, but we only have less than 10 members here. So the Secretariat will issue a circular to consult other members. I call a quorum. Quorum count, please, Chairman. He made the request. That's his point of order. He called for a quorum call. Please ring the bell. Please ring the quorum bell. Yeah, we can stop the bell now. We have a quorum. So the meeting's resumed. Mr. Zhang, We counted the quorum. We have a quorum now. I don't know whether we have 30 members here. No. So, Chairman, so you're going to write to members and consult their views, whether they agree to have 5 meetings a month. And if you don't have enough support, then that's the end of the Bills Committee's work. Let me make it clear. Just now, I already asked members if we are to submit a report to the House Committee by the middle of June, regardless of whether there is an impasse still at the House Committee, then according to my estimate, we need 5 or even 10 meetings. So I will send a circular to me, to members, from early May to mid-June. Do members agree to hold 10 meetings in order to complete the BC's work? And after we collect the reply slips, the Secretariat will then collect the information. And at the next meeting, I'll report to members how we're going to handle it. Dr. Pierre Chen. Right, I spoke already. Yes, Mr. Wong Teng Kwong. Chairman, I think this is wishful thinking. We need to be pragmatic. I'm not saying I don't support having meetings. But from Monday to Friday, even Saturday, do you realize the huge backlog we have for council business, even if the appropriation bill is passed? How many council meetings we still have on Wednesdays and Thursdays? Because on Wednesday and Thursdays, we have council meetings and we also have a finance committee with additional meetings. I suppose you received a circular as well. You've been notified, right? We have other panels. So we can't divide ourselves and take part in every meeting. If you want 10 meetings and if you want a report to be submitted to HC by mid-June, we have only slightly more than a month left. How can we do that? We have 6 days a week, except Sunday. And 2 days are reserved. We have 4 days left. And also, Finance Committee on Friday. So we only have 3 days available in a week. Not to mention other Bills Committee and other panel meetings. We usually have 2-hour meetings for the BC. So, what slots are still available? You can check your own schedule. Mr. Wong, I take your point. I've heard you loud and clear. This is wishful thinking. But you cannot disregard reality. Right, thank you. Thank you for your gentle reminder. I take your point. I understand members' concern, be it meeting venues, secretariats, and the administration schedule. All these concerns are legitimate. At the same time, I need to give full disclosure of all the information available. I can only make it very clear. That is, I need to put it down very clearly in the circular whether members think we can have 10 meetings in the coming month, whether you agree to have these meetings. So just state your position in the reply slip. Then what will happen then? Chairman, we cannot just have a talk shop. I understand that, but it also affects the scheduling of meetings. Well, Mr. Wong, if more members agree that we should have meetings more frequently, I will work out a schedule with the Secretariat. If timing permits and if venue permits, arrangements will be made. However, if more members are of the view that it is quite impossible, then we can decide on our schedule then. I respect members' views, so I will be issuing circulars. What about the next meeting? We have monthly meetings. Right, you've just reminded me. I hope the Secretariat can collect members' reply slips within this week after issuing the circular, and then I'll make a decision. I won't wait for the next meeting. After collecting all reply slips, the Secretariat will collate the information, and then another circular would be issued to inform members. Thank you, Mr. Ray Chan. Mr. Tommy Zhao, I want to clarify. Well, from now to mid-June, we have 6 weeks. Do members agree to have 2-hour meeting for 10 meetings? Is that the basis? Or are you going to find available slots and venues first? Right, thank you. I will ask the Secretariat to pencil down available venues as well. Right, we need to be pragmatic. Any other suggestions from members? If not, then are there other questions for the administration? The administration will work with us. Right, that's her reply. Mr. Tommy Cheung, you'd like to continue to ask questions? Right, I raised my hand just now for a second round. Second round today, we have Mr. Tommy Cheung and Mr. Peter Shou. We don't have a lot of time, so each will be given 5 more minutes. Mr. Tommy Cheung, I have a question for the DS. You gave us information about Japan and Korea, and then you provided figures, percentages in terms of HNB users and e-cigarettes users. And then you referred to increase in the number of HNB users and e-cigarette users. I want to know whether these figures are duplicates. Say if you have more HNB users. In fact, these are dual users. They would go for conventional cigarettes if HNB are not available. And then can you give us a percentage of these dual cigarette users? And just now another member, without naming me, asked me not to be, I don't want to repeat. I just want to say very calmly that some members do not prepare CSAs. They just use the tactic of calling for quorums. While I prepare CSAs, I do my job. And anyway, may I ask the Bureau to read paragraphs 6 and 7 of the paper, then further elucidate these figures in the paragraphs? Because I'm sorry to say that I don't find these figures credible, because you don't give the total truth. You keep some facts from the public. So I need you to explain this. Yes? Dr. Fong, about smoking prevalence in Korea, the e-cigarette uptake rate increased quite significantly rapidly since its introduction. That is why some members ask for the trend, and we correspondingly provided some information in these paragraphs about the smoking prevalence trend in Korea. And the source of information are provided in our footnotes. In terms of the use of HNB products in adult population, in Japan and Korea last year, some major studies were published last year, and according to these studies, in terms of sampling size, they are quite representative in their populations, and these studies are related to HNB products. 1 salient point from these studies is the population figures who are e-cigarette users and HNB users. because previous studies suggested that switching from conventional cigarettes to e-cigarettes or HNB products could reduce health risk. But according to the FDA report, the ingredients of e-cigarettes may have lower toxicity than conventional products. But there is a precondition, that is, the user should have totally switched from e-cigarette to conventional cigarettes.
But we do not have enough figures to show whether all the traditional cigarette smokers would adopt HNB products. Well, last year, there was a large-scale research done in Korea showing that most of them using HNB products are also using traditional cigarettes. In Japan, 60% of them do that, and then in Korea, it's around 95% or so. Our chairman, well, before my 5 minutes are up, I want to say that you give us many comparison in numbers. However, I just want to know whether the HNB product will actually, the introduction of HNB product will give rise to the number of smokers. Well, so, a member said that this might take out the stigma and that there is a larger appeal for HNB products and think that it's actually a cool thing to do. I want to try to understand your big data. Does the introduction of HNB products actually increase the number of smokers, especially in young smokers? E-cigarettes are actually very cheap and they are really hazardous to health. But HNB products are quite expensive and we do not have any data to prove that they are hazardous. I just want to try to understand what you say. In paragraph 8, we see the latest Korean survey. In 2018, a large-scale survey was done showing that 2.8% of adolescents aged 12 to 18 had used HNB products in 2018. Well, this is a fact figure on the use of HNB products by adolescents. HNB products are actually quite a new product. Therefore, we do not really have too many figures. And a low prevalence in population would not show very accurate figures. So this is the only data that we are using from Korea. Well, you didn't break these down. You just give us the big data. I see in paragraph 8, I am actually looking at it right now. You said that over 96% of the users are dual users and 2.1% of adult population use HNB products. Do HNB products actually increase the number of traditional smokers? Or do you have any figure showing that? If the FDA shows that HNB products are less hazardous, I can bring you some data to show you. Well, I have done all my research. I can tell you all the pros and cons of the HNB products. So you can look at paragraph 4 here to understand whether any HNB product users have never smoked before. You can see that 9.3% of HNB product users had never smoked cigarettes before. Mr. Shiu Ka-fai. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to ask the administration, what is the percentage of HNB product users in Hong Kong currently? We'll need more data, but we need to look at the census numbers. But we do not have the data yet. Well, HNB products are new products, and in 2015 and 2017, we only asked about e-cigarettes. So that means you don't know. Well, can I tell you that about half of the people changed to the use of HNB products? What would you say? Well, I will still need to look at the census numbers. Newspaper stall owners tell me that many people have already switched to HNB products. Those entering Hong Kong can pay duty for their HNB products. So how much duty have you actually charged in the past year? Thank you. In 2018 to 2019, we only see some visitors declaring HNB products and some coming via mail. 1.739 million. And for cigarettes, it's around listed cigarettes at around 911,000. So that means it's around 0.03%. Thank you. Let's say in Hong Kong, you see someone using HNB products and you say that he hasn't paid any duty. Is he actually contravening any regulation in Hong Kong? And is he susceptible to a fine? Well, we'll see whether this is for personal use. For adults over 18 years, they can bring in 15 cigarettes per person. If he can prove that he has paid any duty, then we can treat it as a case. The highest fine is imprisonment of 2 years. Chairman, let me tell you what's happening. What is the so for every 1,000 of cigarettes, the tax, the duty is $1,906. So how much you get per year from 2018 to 2019? $630 million. $631 million. $6.3 billion. So that's $6.3 billion. Or 10% is already around $600 million in duty. But then the Customs Excise Department said that they only receive 1 million or so. That means many people have not paid the duty tax. I want to remind you, around 7,000 people have been arrested during the social protests. Now many people use HNB products. If you do not enforce the law, then you you wouldn't arrest anyone. But then actually, if you do enforce the law, then you would be able to arrest many people. You're setting a trap for people. You're actually misleading the public because people will unknowingly use HNB products and they can be imprisoned for up to 2 years. Thank you. Mr. Tommy Chung, I have to leave 5 minutes for AOB. And there's another meeting at 4:30, so I cannot hold up the room. Is there any AOB? If not, then we can now adjourn the meeting today. Thank you.